There are 6 types of synovial joints, and depending on the type, there's going to be differing types of articulations between the two, so how well the bones fit together, and that has implications in terms of what types of movement the synovial joints will allow. So we'll start with ball and socket joints. We have a good idea, we can visualize what a ball and socket joint would be. So the best example and the most freely movable joint here is your shoulder joint. And the actual name for your shoulder joint is your glenohumeral joint. So you're going to have your ball on the humerus and your socket on the scapula. All right, so what's key here is how well these actually articulate with one another. So you have this fairly shallow socket, the fairly bulbous head of the humerus, that's going to mean that you actually don't have a very good fit between these two bones. So this will allow for more movement in this region. So these type of joints are what's referred to as multi-axial. So it can move in numerous axes. So it can move anteriorly, posteriorly, medial, lateral, and we'll talk about those different types of movements in more detail. So these are going to be the most freely movable of your synovial joints. So think about where your other ball and socket joint is. So we have your shoulder, the other one would be in your hip or your coxal joint. So those are the two main examples of ball and socket joints. Okay, plane joints. Plane joints, in terms of their articulating surfaces, are almost exactly flat. So as you would see in this right here, the ends of the bones are almost completely flat, allowing for these bones to almost slide past one another, okay? So these are typically biaxial. Sometimes they can actually be multiaxial as well. One of the best examples is your AC joint, or acromioclavicular joint, so the acromion process of your scapula, and the lateral end of your clavicle. So you'll actually have a slight movement here in order for it to go up and down, and sometimes even anterior and posterior. Pivot joints are exactly what they sound like. That's the good thing about these classification schemes, are they are fairly intuitive into what they're actually allowing with movement. So pivot joint, we have on here elbow joint, but it's a specific portion of your elbow joint. Your proximal radio ulnar joint. So when you have radio, think radius, and then the ulnar. So this proximal end of these two bones. And as you can see here, you have this ligament right here, which is going to allow for the radial head to pivot, okay? So you'll have this slight pivot, which is important in terms of your pronation and supination in this region right here. All right, hinge joint. This is another one that we think about quite a bit. Some of your larger joints are going to be hinge joints. We're looking right here at your true elbow joint, or your humero-ulnar. So at this portion right here, that's going to allow you to flex and extend only in one axis. So these are uniaxial joints. Another main hinge joint is your knee joint. And we'll talk a lot about the knee joint. That's actually your most complex joint in your body. Saddle joints. So one of the articulating surfaces of saddle joints looks like a saddle. The other bone looks like it's sitting within the saddle. So the best example of that is your first carpometacarpal joint. So when you're thinking of your first digit or your thumb, this metacarpal where it's articulating with your trichetral bone, one of your carpal bones. Now there's actually quite a bit of movement that can be allowed here. You can have flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, and anytime that you have flexion, extension, abduction, and adduction, that allows for circumduction. So if you can have those four complexes of movement, that allows for circumduction, which allows for you to spin like this, okay? Same thing here in terms of your conjular joints, just their articulating surfaces are shaped slightly differently. So these metacarpophalangeal joints, they're not going to be as deep in terms of their articulation on your proximal phalanx and this is not quite as bulbous as what you had with your saddle joints. But same thing here, flexion, extension, abduction, and adduction, which will allow for some degree of circumduction.